intermittent fasting.
Intermittent fasting.
When you eat could be as important as what you eat.
Intermittent fasting.
Intermittent fasting.
Yes.
Intermittent fasting has really changed my life.
Intermittent fasting is one of the hottest buzzwords at the moment, but its current popularity is mainly due to the media promoting it as some fad diet that can greatly stimulate weight loss and burn fat in the body. But what if the best thing about intermittent fasting isn't what it can do for your waistline, but the many ways it can boost brain function and prevent neurodegenerative brain disease? It could very well be more than just a fad diet, and instead be the most effective means of regenerating and protecting our bodies and minds. Might intermittent fasting be the healthiest way to live? Let's find out. To make things easier, I've divided this video into four sections that you can navigate to and from using the chapters in the description below. In the description, I've also included a link to a poster that I created exclusively for you guys to download. The poster describes and compares the different methods of fasting intermittently and also offers some practical yet important advice so you can decide what the best regimen for you is. So go ahead and download it, it's free. And to be honest, I worked really hard on it. So in the interests of full disclosure, I think I have to tell you guys that I'm in the middle of a 72-hour intermittent fast right now, as I'm filming this video. In fact, I decided to create this video from start to finish, a process that includes research, scripting, filming, publishing, and promoting the video, all while I was fasting. And, well, it was surprisingly easy. I'd go even as far as say that it was much easier than it usually is. That's because I feel more energetic and motivated right now than I usually do. I also think I'm a little more creative, as I seem to be constantly coming up with a lot of new and cool ideas. My mind feels clearer and I feel more grounded and focused. Plus, I'm not even hungry. All this despite me not having eaten anything for the best part of 3 days. That's because in spite of everything that we've been told to believe, fasting intermittently is not starving. In fact, our ancient ancestors did it all the time. So whenever I'm having a difficult time understanding why the human body works the way it does, or as happens way too often, stops working as it should, I like to think back to our ancient ancestors and what life was like for them. How their bodies had to change and adapt to the environment around them so that they could survive and thrive in a largely hostile world. It's a legacy that's more than 150,000 years old, and one that we, despite all our technologies and advancements, continue to live with and still have no control over. But the reason I'm telling you all of this is because for most of our history, we were little more than lowly hunter-gatherers, meaning that we regularly had to endure regular periods of food scarcity. In other words, our ancestors would have gone through long and regular periods without food, and the longer that they went without food, the more creative and motivated they had to be to find it, or else they would have just died.
Quite the paradox, isn't it?
It seems like the less food we have and the hungrier that we become, the harder we must work to find that food. All the while, the resources we use to find food, namely our body's energy reserves, continue to dwindle. It's almost as if our bodies and minds are designed to function more efficiently when we fast. This might explain why I and the countless others who've tried intermittent fasting feel like we are the best versions of ourselves when we do. But don't take my word for it, because the science is also fairly convincing. Many people would agree that the hardest part of any fast is the first 12 hours. That's because it's during these first 12 hours that the liver breaks down its glycogen reserves, turning glycogen into glucose that your body cells can then turn into energy. There are about 700 to 900 calories worth of glycogen in the liver. Every time we eat, these glycogen reserves are quickly replenished, and if we continue to eat once the liver's glycogen reserves are full, any extra calories we consume are stored in our bodies as fat. This is why 12 hours is considered by most to be the shortest intermittent fast that you can do, because before that, you're simply just not fasting. Interestingly, you can superspeed the transition into the fasted state by doing some exercise. A 1 hour run, for example, burns around 600 calories of energy, meaning that you'd enter the fasted state in roughly 4 instead of 12 hours.
So, what exactly happens in this fasted state?
Metabolic switching is what happens. Once we run out of glycogen, our bodies begin to look elsewhere to meet the energy demands of its 37.2 trillion living cells. That's when the liver begins breaking down fats into ketones that include acetoacetate and beta-hydroxybutyrate. But we'll just agree to call that last one BHB from now on. Cool? Anyway, this process is called ketogenesis, and interestingly, the liver is not the only place where it happens. Astrocytes in the brain are also capable of ketogenesis. The ketones that they produce, especially BHB, become the most important energy source for the 86 billion neurons that make up your and my brains. And the approximately 86 neurons that US President Joe Biden has left. Despite only being the brain's second choice for food after glucose, ketones seem to be an overall better source of energy that is significantly more efficient than glucose ever is. However, it would be a mistake to think of BHB purely as just an energy source or brain food, because it also happens to be a signaling molecule in the brain, where it activates several interesting pathways. First, because it is a more efficient source of energy, BHB decreases inflammation in the brain and the body as a whole. And second, it also upregulates the expression of brain-derived neurotrophic factor, BDNF for short, which does a few things. These include protecting immature and vulnerable brain cells, thus ensuring their survival, stimulating the growth of existing nerve cells so they are more readily able to form new connections with each other, promoting mitochondrial regeneration, which is vital as the mitochondria are where either glucose or ketone bodies are turned into actual energy. Over time, this is believed to make brain cells more resilient to stress. And finally, BDNF also boosts neurogenesis in the dentate gyrus, a region of the brain that continues to divide and produce new nerve cells all throughout adult life. The dentate gyrus is involved in learning and in memory. By the way, exercise happens to be another excellent way of boosting BDNF levels in the brain. If you would like to find out how and why, check out this video I made on that very subject once you're done watching this one. Finally, BHB does this cool thing where it tells your brain to eat itself up. Not literally, but like also literally. You probably guessed that I'm talking about autophagy, which is the mechanism our bodies use to remove damaged or malfunctioning cells and organelles, as well as digest malformed proteins, like beta amyloid plaques and alpha synuclein proteins. BHB and other ketones are believed to help clear up these malformed proteins by decreasing the activity of the mTOR pathway. If you watched the last few videos that I made about the gut microbiome and how it affects the brain, then you might remember that beta amyloid and alpha synuclein are the proteins responsible for Alzheimer's and Parkinson's diseases, respectively. This is important because Alzheimer's and Parkinson's happen to be the most and second most common neurodegenerative conditions. In the United States, nearly 6 million people are living with Alzheimer's disease, a number that translates to 10 to 14% of all adults aged 65 and over, according to the CDC. Here's where intermittent fasting comes in. As it happens, we have several great studies that show that intermittent fasting can improve cognition in adults living with Alzheimer's disease. Intermittent fasting was also found to reduce the beta amyloid precursors in the brains of healthy individuals. And finally, in a third study, it enhanced cognitive performance on a battery of tests in patients who had mild cognitive impairment, sometimes considered to be pre-Alzheimer's. And while Parkinson's has not been as extensively studied in human subjects, we do have some encouraging results from animal models. In rodents, for example, 3 cycles of intermittent fasting were sufficient to improve motor skills and even reduce the loss of dopaminergic neurons in the brain substantia nigra, a hallmark of the disease. In another study on monkeys, Scientists observed reduced motor deficits and increased dopamine levels in the animal brains following 6 to 10 months of a time-restricted feeding intermittent fast. If you'd like to read the full research papers yourself, you should find all the references I used to make this video over on Substack. And while you're down there, don't forget to give this video a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel to learn all about how your brain works and how you can make it work even better. My name is Hashim, and I'm a medical doctor and University of Cambridge graduate, and as far as I know, all my subscribers are nice people. So why don't you join the little squad that we have going on? It would be wrong to think that the benefits of intermittent fasting are limited to just Alzheimer's and Parkinson's. In fact, we have studies that show that it can also be beneficial in multiple sclerosis, stroke, epilepsy, autism, and mood and anxiety disorders. There is definitely much more to talk about that one video could possibly ever cover. Still, I think I should probably also add that while the ketogenic or keto diet is certainly not a form of intermittent fasting, it seems like it might share many of intermittent fasting's benefits for the brain. Because both the ketogenic diet and intermittent fasting rely on the same end result, ketogenesis and ketone, especially BHB, production. Our way of life today, where food is consumed over 3 meals a day, plus snacks, in between may be doing significantly more damage to our brains than to our waistlines. There is a lot of evidence to support the idea that our human biology just isn't geared towards that way of life. We started transitioning into an agricultural society with more predictable and dependable food supplies more than 12,000 years ago. Still, I think it's important to remember that in evolutionary timescales, 12,000 years is but a drop in nature's very big bucket. Now, let's talk about me, because I feel so good and so productive right now that I think I might make intermittent fasting a part of my life with a continuous 2 to 3 day fast every week for the foreseeable future, if not the rest of my life. To put it simply, I got more work done in those 3 days than I typically get done in an entire week. And I think if nothing else, that's worth it. Will you try intermittent fasting? Let me know in the comments, and don't forget to download my free poster that shows you all the different fasting regimens that you can try so you can choose the best one for you. See you all next week, and try your best to stay safe until then.